last couple of weeks we've been talking about, we did that two-part thing about faith, about blind faith, and about how we express faith just by driving down the road. And we have enough faith that car is going to stay on that lane. We have enough faith that, you know, these pumps that we buy our fuel from are going to be right. We have faith over things we have no control over, but we have to do it, right? We got to get it done. So we step back and say, well, I just hope to God that truck stays on his right side. I hope to God all this food that I'm buying, I'm not being charged over and over and over for it. We have to have faith, because otherwise we would go nuts. We would worry about every little thing. We would worry about every little time in our life, every little thing we're supposed to do. We would worry because we have no control over the person driving down the road. We have no control over these machines. Amen? So let's practice our faith and things that we have control over. Your story. This is who you are, J.J. This is when you first started coming to the Sober Project. You fell in love with Jesus Christ, and he came into your life. You guys got married. We had a great time, and you guys have been part of this church for 8 years, 9 years now, forever. Yeah. And still, you know we're homeless. You may not be around much. People have been here maybe for years and never seen you. But you're in and out. You do what you can. But this is your home. You have faith that this is your home. With the newcomers, you come and you see a bunch of empty chairs. Well, this one must not be that good of a church if there's so many empty chairs. I'd like to let you know, first time is there's been thousands of people that have come through these chairs in the last 11 years. Literally thousands of people. Maybe tens of thousands that have come through here. Because this is a place where God works. And our faith is brought to a place of almost, it definitely being tested. Our faith is definitely tested. And then our character is tested. Who are you? Who do you think you are? And how do you carry yourself? We let so many things worry about us, keep us worried. So many things, finances, money. Money is such a big issue until you have enough of it. That's not an issue anymore. Until that's not enough. And then everything's fine. If I just got a raise, you know, if I got $1 million, I would tithe for sure if I had $1 million. You won't tithe on $10. How are you going to tithe on $1 million? It's character. It's the character that's got to shape you. What happens in here in this church is God will show you how he wants you to act. And he expects you to act that way. Now, he don't expect you to get it right. He expects you to fail. That's why there's grace. That's why Jesus went to the cross. Because we will fail. But we know where to find our faith. We turn around and say, Lord, I'm sorry. What am I doing over here? I don't know. I'm sorry. Why am I? I don't know. But here I'm back home again, where I belong, to start from part A again. This is where life changes. And this is where your life changes other people's lives. Your life changes other people's lives. Not only is your life changed, but your life, JJ has his testimony, and it changes lives. Your testimony changes lives. Listen up, you guys. Oh, it's just called listen up. Once in a while, I want you to get shaken up a little bit. I want you to think a little bit about who you are. What God's doing in your life, what God expects from you. Sure, we got all this faith and all this stuff. It's great. You know, God's blessing us. You know, we're out of prison now. We're out of this now. I can't get my hair to work. Darn it. There we go. But the fact is that now that you've got something, God wants you to share it. Listen to this. Listen to this. The first part of the sermon, this is out of Psalms, says, "All my people, listen to my instructions. Open your ears to what I am saying. For I will speak to you in a parable. I will teach you hidden treasures. from your past. The men's group, we spent how long in Psalms and Proverbs? We spent forever and just going over them and reading them and trying to break them down. We look at parables, at those stories that Jesus talks about, Jesus tells, like in Matthew, and when we see, he's telling us more of more than just a story. He's showing us, he's teaching us. And when he teaches, Jesus looks for opportunities, windows of opportunities, to use that time to teach us something. Amen? This is the Old Testament speaking out. He says, that for I will speak to you in a parable, God says. I will teach you hidden lessons from our past. Stories we have heard and known. Stories our ancestors handed down to us. The parables and the Psalms were all written at the time of David, and then the Proverbs were written at the time of his son, who was King Solomon. So this is all in the time when the Jews were just really getting strong, and then they were opening up the temple, and they were teaching in the temple. And he says, verse 3 says, stories we have heard and known, stories our ancestors handed down to us. We will not hide these truths from our children. We will tell you, the next generation, about the glorious deeds of the Lord. See what you guys, look at this. We will not hide these truths from our children. The Bible says that we will not hide these truths from our children, so that our children will know. So that the more they know, the better equipped they are, the better choices they'll be able to make. And what we talk about in this church, man, everything's a choice. You choose one or the other. You choose life or you choose death. That's all the choices you have. You have either choose life or you choose death. That's all you have. We suggest life. And then when you choose death, crawdad out of there, back out of there and ask them to repent. Repent and ask God to tell God you're sorry and back out of there and go back to work. Because you're not going to hit it right every time, but when you hit it and you know you're wrong, back out. Don't force it. Don't try to make it work. Well, I'm going to go to this other church. I don't care if it is. I'm going to make it work. I'm going to make it work. No, man. God's got a plan. Stick to his plan. He brought you to a place. Why are you running away? First verse says, we will not hide these truths from our children. We will tell the next generations about the glorious deeds of the Lord. Amen? About his power and his mighty wonders. For he issued his laws to Jacob. He gave his instructions to Israel. He commanded our ancestors to teach them to their children, so the next generation and the next generation and the next generation might know them. Even the children not yet born. Amen, church? Amen. These are for us to teach our children. The Psalms and the Proverbs are all ways of living to becoming godly men and godly women. These are all ways to carry yourself and become the character that God is designing in you. A character that somebody's honest, that your word is your word. Someone that is truthful. Someone that can be trustworthy. That's who God is creating in you now. For who we were before, we weren't that trustworthy. And I can't even get one amen out of you. And you all know all of you were not trustworthy. None of you. We said, Mama back there, she's okay. I bet you she got some stories to tell you. Amen, 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 amen. So the next generation might know them, even the children not yet born, and they will turn, and they will turn, and they in turn will teach their own children. So each generation should set its hope anew on God, not forgetting his glorious miracles and obeying his commandments.
Amen.
Man. The simplicity of it is once you get into this and you start working it on a daily basis, you start reading your Bible every day, you start following what he says, you start looking and knowing God, it becomes an automatic. It becomes part of your lifestyle, man. And you can't forget what got you where you're at. Because it's real easy to drift away. And what's got you the most, what's given you the most, is your story. This is who you were. You ladies, your story is so fresh. It's just months. When you came out, you came bouncing in here. Came bouncing in here with a list of things that had to get done. And you started at it. And here we find out that you're in school. Both of you are going to school. You're both working. God is using and working in you. You're finding God. You're working. God's working in your life. All that stuff. That's why we're here. Is that anybody can walk out the streets and instantly start a relationship with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And when that moment on, man, it's all glittering. Good stuff, man, because God's with you. Your life is going to be upside down, but Christ will be with you right there, upside down with you. It's a beautiful thing. So let's remember. Let's go into Philippians. I want to talk about what we need to do. We need to teach. You need to teach. Did you know that you are teachers? You're teachers, man. You're teachers at so many different levels, man. You're working with these kids. You're teaching these kids. You're working in whatever your business you're in, you're teaching. You're always teaching. And you're always learning, God willing. Because if you're not, then you're going to be stagnant. But look what it says here in Philippians, at verse 12. It says, and I want church.
You know.
Say it again.
You know.
I want you to know, my dear brothers and sisters, that
everything
that has happened to
me
here has
helped to spread the good news.
Now, at this time in this book, Paul's in jail again. Can anybody relate?
Yeah.
Come on, man.
Come on, man.
He's in jail, but he's going to use his time. He's doing his time, but he's going to use this time for the glory of God.
Amen.
He's in prison. Locked up. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And God's going to use this to share the good news. What's the good news?
Jesus.
What about Jesus? The good news is the gospel. Jesus died for your sins. And if you call him into your heart and you believe, you're going to heaven. That's the great news. That's the truth. So it says that whatever he's going through, man, no matter what he's been going through, he's working in the coal mines, he's busting rocks, whatever he's doing, he says, whatever has happened to me here has happened to spread the good news. Verse 13, for everyone here, including the
church.
Come on now, church, man. The whole seal breathes. We're all lined up. Huh? The 3 OCs are all lined up. They're singing, man, Jesus, praise the Lord. Maybe not quite, but you're feeling me, guys. You're feeling me. He says here that the whole palace guard knows that I am
in chains
because of
Christ.
There ain't no doubt. He ain't going to take a minute to let go. He goes, yeah, I'm here. He's loud. He's going to make everybody see what he is, and he can come. He's going to say, if you want some,
come get some.
That's how he rolls, man. He's rolling with thunder, man. He says, come on. Come here, you guys. The guards are right there. He's like, let me tell you about Jesus. Did you know that he died for you? Did you know that you can go to heaven? Okay, Ned's gay. Do you know who Jesus is? He went down the line. He said, for everyone here, including the whole palace guard, knows that I am in chains because of Christ. And because of my
imprisonment,
most of the believers here have
gained
more confidence. Or another word would be faith. They're in there stagnant. Ain't nobody talking about Jesus. Here he comes in prison in his new black. Is that the orange? The new orange? The new black or the new orange or whatever I'm saying. But here he comes in and he's going to eat his food. Lord, bless my food. Thank you, Jesus. Bless my food. Oh, yeah, you draw a little half a fish. And somebody come up and draw another half a fish. Oh, you're a Christian too. He goes, no, man, be quiet. Be loud.
Amen.
Be proud of who you are, man. Be proud that you're a believer, man. Let people know
Amen.
That you follow Jesus Christ. Man, what, you ashamed? You got something to hide? Huh?
No.
Man. No, man, because we had that. He did that already. Now we know the truth. And even when I screw up, I'm okay, because God's going to forgive me.
Amen.
Every time I preach, every time I speak, it's the word of God, not me. Don't get mad at me, get mad at God. Verse 14 says, and because of my imprisonment, most of the believers here have gained confidence and boldly speak
God's message without fear.
One crazy little dude started a whole ruckus. Now all that Jesus preached was talking about God. Everybody be praying over their food. Everybody walking in together talking about Jesus. Because one crazy little dude started talking about Jesus. What would happen at your work if you started a little Bible study at lunchtime? If you just started, well, you know how it is when these crazy people come up and want to pray at the restaurant. You get a chance to pray at the restaurant. Always look for the opportunity to shine the light on you, but not you. You know what I'm saying? Shed on Christ that is in you.
Amen.